Hi, good morning, everyone. Thanks for attending our CA conference and coming in today for this session on safety implications of medical device cybersecurity. Will be presented by Penny Chase, Information Technology and Cybersecurity Integrator at MITRE, and Margie Zook, Senior Principal Cybersecurity Engineer at MITRE. Thanks and enjoy the session.
Okay, well, thank you. So I'm Penny Chase, and I'd first like to say that originally Suzanne Schwartz of FDA's Center for Devices and Radiologic Health was supposed to give the talk along with Margie. But Suzanne's group, in addition to working on medical device cybersecurity, oversees emergency medical countermeasures. And as you can imagine, they're very busy up to here with coronavirus activities. So Suzanne really couldn't break away to come to RSA. So we're going to pinch hit and hope that you enjoy it. So today, most medical devices are now connected to networks. They, like any computer connected to a network, has software. And like any software, there can be vulnerabilities. And if those vulnerabilities are not remediated and taken care of, the devices can potentially be exploited. And that can result in patient harm or possibly serve as a pivot point for an adversary to get onto a hospital's network. The bottom line is the presence of these vulnerabilities can lead to the compromise of the confidentiality, integrity, and availability of devices. And ultimately, that can lead to patients not trusting these devices and not being willing to receive medical care that they need. So to improve the security of medical devices really is shared responsibility among a broad range of stakeholders, ranging from the manufacturers who build the systems to healthcare organizations that buy the systems, to clinicians that operate these systems, to patients who receive their care from them. And then you also have security researchers who find the vulnerabilities in that software, in those medical devices. And when those vulnerabilities are disclosed, there are players who are involved in coordinating that disclosure, including DHS's CISA, FDA, and the various information sharing and analysis organizations that have been standing up to help share information about medical device vulnerabilities. So FDA has been looking at medical device cybersecurity since about 2013, when a couple of executive orders about cybersecurity of critical infrastructure were issued. And also in that year, there was the first major disclosure of medical device vulnerabilities, sort of 400 devices of 40 different manufacturers. And in response, FDA started to be concerned about improving the security of medical devices and took a multi-pronged approach. You know, as a regulator, they issued guidance, and guidance represents FDA's current thinking about various issues to, provide, the recommendations to manufacturers on how to approach issues. So in 2014, they issued the pre-market guidance, helping manufacturers understand what they should include about security in their submissions. In 2016, they issued post-market guidance, what to do about handling vulnerabilities after a device is actually on the market. In addition, when warranted, they issued safety communications about vulnerabilities discovered in devices. And, so basically that's kind of the regulatory hat. The other side was FDA acting as a convener. As I said before, they recognize that medical device cybersecurity is a shared responsibility. And starting in 2014, they convened a series of public workshops to bring that broad group of stakeholders together to develop a whole of community approach to addressing medical device cybersecurity. So the first one was held in 2014, and the last one was actually held last year. In addition to just convening the community, FDA reached out to partners in the government, such as DHS, to the Health the Information Sharing and Analysis Center for the sector, and the various ISOs that have stood up to help convey information among their members about vulnerabilities. And FDA signed memoranda of understanding with all these groups to further the collaboration in this space. In last year, FDA explicitly issued a challenge to medical device manufacturers to participate in DEF CON's biohacking village. They really wanted manufacturers to not view hackers as the enemy, but that hackers could actually help improve the security of devices. And on the other side, they, you know, recognizing that at the center of this are patients. FDA, they have a patient engagement advisory committee that helps them understand the patient perspective. And they convened a meeting last September devoted to medical device cybersecurity to get that perspective. And then there are another number of other activities that FDA has been doing that MITRE's been helping out with, and Margie's going to talk about those later. So to talk a little bit about a couple of the points on that slide, first I'd like to talk about the pre-market guidance. So in the pre-market guidance, FDA really articulated the fact that medical device cybersecurity is a shared responsibility among multiple stakeholders. It also calls on device manufacturers to address cybersecurity during the design and development of devices by incorporating security controls that align with the cybersecurity framework. And they recommended the types of documentation they would like to see during pre-market submissions that would convey to FDA what manufacturers have been doing in terms of the design elements addressing cybersecurity, and also to describe the kind of plan they have in place for managing vulnerabilities that aligns with CFR 820, which is the quality system regulation. So moving to the post-market side, once a device is on the market, vulnerabilities can arise, and FDA issued guidance on helping manufacturers understand, you know, what they ought to do, what their responsibilities are when vulnerabilities are discovered. They recommend using a risk-based framework to assure that these security risks are handled continually and in a fashion, and that framework should align with the NIST cybersecurity framework. They also, you know, they felt they didn't need new regulatory authority, but highlighted the manufacturer's responsibilities under existing regulations, and they tried to foster a collaborative environment, try to get manufacturers to be more open about sharing information about vulnerabilities. And they really included an incentive to get manufacturers to engage in the right behavior. So one of the central elements of the post-market guidance was trying to shift the manufacturer's mindset in how they conduct cybersecurity risk assessment. They wanted manufacturers to stop thinking about likelihood and the intended use of the device, and shift to thinking about how a device can be exploited, and that there's a malicious adversary out there who actually wants to abuse the device, not use it as it was intended. So this is sort of summarized in this gradient picture that's in the guidance, where on one axis you have exploitability, on the other axis you have the severity of patient harm, and you have this gradient showing the risk from the high risk bad stuff at the top down to low risk at the bottom. The third dimension is whether or not a vulnerability is controlled. And so as you can move from an uncontrolled vulnerability down to a controlled vulnerability, you kind of shift that risk downward. And so this was to graphically illustrate, you know, how they wanted manufacturers to start thinking about cybersecurity risk assessment. And this was part of, I mentioned that FDA wanted to incentivize right behavior. And so this is part of their incentive that is included in the post-market guidance. If a vulnerability is discovered and a manufacturer meets three criteria, they're relieved from a reporting requirement under the regulations. And the three conditions are that there is no patient harm, so a vulnerability is discovered, but nothing's actually happened yet. That within a 30 and 60 day time frame, the manufacturer can communicate and mitigate all the way to controlling the risk of the vulnerability. And finally, that manufacturers are active participants in an information sharing and analysis organization. So if all those three conditions are met, the manufacturer is relieved from a very onerous reporting requirement. So during this time frame, I mean, FDA has been at this for about over six years now. Their thinking has evolved based on different things that have happened. So they've seen coordinated disclosures where we get to ground truth right away. We're able to develop mitigations and they get communicated and rolled out. And that's a good thing. On the other hand, we've also seen situations where there hasn't been coordinated disclosure. There's a lot of arguments and debates about what the real risk is, what the mitigations are the mitigations effective. There's a lot of FUD, you know, there aren't clear communications, and that's like a bad thing. So, you know, FDA kind of seeing that, they want to try and move us towards good coordinated disclosures. We've also seen real cases where there have been malware attacks that have had an impact on the health and public health infrastructure and potentially disrupt care. You know, the poster child for this, of course, is WannaCry in 2017, which had a drastic impact on the national health system in the UK. And a few months later, we had the NotPetya destructiveware attack, which took out a major pharmaceutical company's manufacturing capability, and also took out Nuance, which is the major provider of medical transcription. And, you know, we've heard stories about hospitals, you know, doctors going online trying to find free transcription services because they didn't have Nuance. One of the reasons why these attacks are so devastating is that patching operating systems, especially in these safety critical systems, legacy medical devices, isn't routine. And, you know, again, how can we go and fix that problem? And manufacturers and hospitals don't even necessarily know what software in their system, so they don't even know if they're vulnerable. And as more vulnerabilities are being discovered, you know, FDA is kind of wrestling with how to deal with the scale of this. And their highest concern are vulnerabilities that have the potential for remote multi-patient harm. And so this led to including some recommendations for medical device cybersecurity in FDA's safety action plan that was published in April 2018. It called for updating the 2014 pre-market guidance, and Margie will talk about that in a little bit. It explored the concept of standing up CIMSAB, a Cyber Med Expert Safety Analysis Board, which would help us get to ground truth in a more timely fashion. And again, Margie's going to talk about some of the work we've done on that. And although FDA has been trying to use carrots to incentivize good behavior, they recognize that maybe that's not enough and they might actually need to go to Congress and ask for new authorities to require that manufacturers build devices that can be patched and updated, and that when they do their pre-market submissions, they include evidence that they have that capability. Require that manufacturers develop a software bill of materials, which they share with their customers, and require that manufacturers have coordinated disclosure policies in place. With that, I will turn things over to Margie.
Good morning. It's good to see people coming in as we're talking. We've wondered how many we'd get this morning, so thank you for getting up early. So we began supporting FDA in 2014 at the time of that first public workshop. And it was really an amazing topic of great interest from the start. We were in a facility in Crystal City that held 200 people. And as we were moderating panels, they were bringing up these sticky notes with questions, lots and lots of questions. It turned out there were 1,100 people on the webinar. So we knew that there was really a lot of interest. At that workshop, we also observed that there were really different views based on different stakeholder groups. So I think that that workshop really set the foundation for a number of things that MITRE has done with FDA. And through these years, we've done, I mean, I have a slide on each of these, so I'll go through them one by one. The first was, a stakeholder study. So as a result of that first workshop, FDA really wanted to understand the different perspectives. And so we did a large study with over 80 organizations, primarily focused on medical device manufacturers, researchers, and healthcare organizations, with some others included as well. But the FDA knew from the very start that the cybersecurity researchers would be a critical part of the ecosystem going forward. And we were able to really hear each side's perspective. And it was really quite an amazing study. It formed a lot of the foundation for everything that we've done since that time. And we, although the larger study was never published, we did publish a journal article with FDA that is available publicly and focuses on all of the issues with medical device cybersecurity throughout the life cycle. Another activity that we've been working on, actually Penny and Steve Christie led this effort for us, was to really look at how effective CVSS was in this healthcare space. And we learned that CVSS itself was suitable, but there was a lot of confusion about the application of it in the healthcare environment. So MITRE set up a working group that consisted of, again, you know, healthcare organizations, medical device manufacturers, cybersecurity researchers, to really look at how CVSS was being used, how vulnerabilities were being scored, and to provide more consistency with the scoring, we developed a rubric that was based very specifically on the healthcare environment. We conducted a number of pilots with manufacturers at different points in the process where we would observe manufacturers determining the severity scores for different types of products. It definitely influenced the document. You'll see from the early drafts to the final draft, a lot of things did change, but it is public now on the MITRE website. And what FDA would like to do is have it qualified as a medical device development tool at FDA, which would mean that when manufacturers used CVSS scoring in their submission, it would be a well-understood approach. So it's currently in the process of being evaluated as a medical device development tool. Another activity we did really grew out of the WannaCry attack, as Penny described. You know, there was certainly a large impact in the UK. You didn't hear as much about the impact in the US, but as we met with different hospital systems and manufacturers, we learned that there really was a lot of confusion between hospitals and manufacturers about the whether or not the vulnerabilities existed on their devices. We believe it's still going on today, actually. We don't know that everything has been fixed. But so we held a workshop in the Boston area. It was actually held at Julian Goldman's medical device plug and play lab at Mass General Hospital, where we brought together a number of hospital systems to really talk about the specifics about that relationship between manufacturers and hospitals during that time of response to a vulnerability. And as a result, we ran larger focus groups at the HIMSS conference, at the health ISAC meetings, and we decided that what we really needed to do was have more information available about the integration of cyber into hospital emergency response plans. Hospitals have very detailed emergency response plans. They plan for diversions of patients and downtime procedures, but thinking about how that might be affected by a cyber adversary and having all the right people at the table to discuss these events when they're happening. So we produced this playbook that has been used by a number of organizations since to help better integrate those throughout the different aspects of the hospital. Another initiative, so that we've been very busy working with FDA over these last 5 years, was called our Medical Device Cybersecurity Sandbox Initiative. As FDA has been involved in all of these negotiations between researchers and manufacturers, there has been more and more of a need for validation of vulnerabilities. As Penny mentioned, you know, we have some good examples where agreement was reached rapidly, but we have some not so good examples where it could take up to a year and a half to come to agreement. And there is a lot of concern about that. So we wanted to explore what it would take to have a medical device sandbox to validate vulnerabilities and bring people together in response to a medical device vulnerability. So we partnered with a number of manufacturers and we partnered also with Julian Goldman at Mass General Hospital to really look at this. And BD participated with us as well as Philips, providing equipment for us to test in the lab. We developed a number of clinical scenarios and use cases, and really looking for mitigation strategies that could be in place for future events, looking at what would it take to create a realistic hospital environment to test devices. And so it was really a wonderful opportunity to explore these things, and we learned a lot about each aspect of that. So the results have been briefed recently at the MedSec conference. There's not a paper on this, but we're hoping to publish more about this in the future. And all of these activities have really helped inform the need for this CyberMed Safety Analysis Board. So as Penny mentioned, FDA proposed this in the Medical Device Safety Action Plan to Congress. It has not been funded, but last year we did spend a year exploring the concept further. And what the idea is to form a public-private partnership that complements existing mechanisms. It's not going to take the place of other things, but it would be a resource for device makers. It would really be a resource for hospitals as well and FDA, and would involve bringing together expertise that's needed to really understand the patient safety impacts and the cybersecurity impacts. So it involves clinicians, it involves manufacturers that really understand the devices. It would involve the really all these different stakeholders that would bring different perspectives into the determination of, you know, the severity of a vulnerability and what the proper mitigation would be. So we, this past year, MITRE held a number of different activities to get stakeholder feedback. We conducted a much smaller stakeholder study than we did the first one early in the year. And then we did a tabletop exercise where we brought together teams of experts and had them really behave as a SIMSAB. We had medical device manufacturers, clinicians, cybersecurity researchers to walk through different scenarios of different types of vulnerabilities, a widespread malware attack versus a device-specific vulnerability or a device specific to a class of vulnerabilities. And the findings were really, they varied for based on the different types of vulnerabilities found. I think that our existing mechanisms can handle some of those cases, but others really have gap areas which surfaced through this year of activity. And some of the features that we think need to be included in this SIMSAB effort in the future, first and foremost, tailored communications. Right now, when a vulnerability alert comes out, an advisory, it is common, generally, from ICS cert, common across all sectors. And so there are, in the hospital systems, certainly in doctors' offices, when doctors are meeting with patients, when patients are involved in informed consent about having a medical device or an embedded device, there is a lot of questions, you know, about cybersecurity. And so to have these advisories include more information that would be better understood by clinicians and patients. I think that's one of the gaps that really came out of this. Vulnerability validation, you know, to create, based on all this work we've done, to be able to create environments where you could get to ground truth quickly, particularly, as Penny mentioned, when there would be a potential for remote multi-patient harm. We also thought that SIMSAB could be tracking the patching and mitigation to really understand what's happening and have a knowledge base from one incident to the next. We talked a lot about membership and governance of this group and, you know, collected a lot of input from all of the parties that participated there. There's also a great need to assist smaller organizations. Unfortunately, we've seen a lot of attacks that are targeting the smaller practices recently and all the ransomware attacks. So we think that there needs to be a real focus on that. Having really knowledge retention from one to the other with a group of experts that bring all those different perspectives is really critical. And then to be involved in all the coordination and response, which we've definitely have been improving over the years, but still needs to be improved. So during 2019, there were a number of key initiatives that FDA led. The first, as Penny mentioned, was the We Heart Hackers Challenge. At that January workshop last year, FDA issued the challenge and got a really wonderful response from manufacturers to participate in DEF CON. There were 10 manufacturers with over 40 devices at the Biohacking Village. And we also brought in a number of people from the clinician community to that. I think that's really important as we move forward. And as Penny mentioned, they also, this year, their Patient Engagement Advisory Committee was focused on cybersecurity. It was a full day. You can look on the FDA website and see the results of that. But it was really an amazing day where they brought together clinicians, cybersecurity experts, and also patients to talk about their experiences and talk about what is needed to really help them better understand the patient safety harm that could be caused by cybersecurity risks. So moving forward for 2020, FDA is still, I will say before we move forward here, it's a small team at FDA, a small team focused on cybersecurity and also preparedness and response. And they really have been very strategic about engaging the community, having people recognize that all parts of the community are critical, including the patients, really. The patients, the researchers, the hospitals, and the manufacturers. So this whole of community approach is really taken as their foundation for how they do everything. So moving forward, the first thing that is going to be coming out is the post-market or the pre-market guidance. There was a draft released last year, and based on, actually it was released in the end of 2018, like December of 2018. And based on all the public comments that for all of the guidance that they published, they have a public guidance period, and they received so many comments that they are going to release another draft shortly. So it will be out for public comment again, but that's coming out soon. Their goal is to complete the CVSS as a medical device. We've submitted the pre-qualification package and it's being reviewed, but the rubric can be used now and a number of manufacturers are using it. The Software Bill of Materials Initiative, Alan Friedman is here and I know he's going to be talking about that. I think it's later today in the innovation sandbox area. But Alan Friedman from NTIA is leading this cross-sector initiative to come to an approach for the software bill of materials. And it's been a wonderful community building this software bill of materials in different sectors. There's been a pilot conducted in the healthcare sector specifically with a number of manufacturers and hospitals, and that's all available on the NTIA site. But you know, the software bill of materials is really critical to understand if you have a vulnerability on your system, especially at the time of one of these preparedness, you know, and response activities. When a vulnerability is announced, the hospital systems are really trying to figure out, you know, what their attack surface is and are they at risk with particular devices. And so having this software bill of materials published by manufacturers in a some kind of a standard language that can be understood is really critical. So FDA has also been involved in the International Medical Device Regulators Forum, where they work with a number of different countries. And FDA and Canada, Health Canada, have been leading the production of a document on medical device cybersecurity. It's called Principles and Practices of Medical Device Cybersecurity, and it looks at security across the whole life cycle. So that's out as a draft currently. And I know for manufacturers, that's really important because there are different requirements with regulators in different countries, and so converging on these requirements will be really, I think, important. And then another initiative that FDA launched is a series of boot camps on threat modeling. So they really want to be able to scale training for manufacturers as the requirements for threat modeling emerge, you know, in medical device submissions. So we actually just held a train the trainer event. This is being done with MDIC, the Medical Device Innovation Consortium, which is a public-private partnership that FDA leads. And Adam Shostak is the trainer there. We brought together a number of manufacturers to be trained on threat modeling, and then we're running two boot camps later this year for medical device manufacturers. They're going to be larger, and then those trainers can go back and train in the medical device organization. So that's the strategy that FDA is taking to really get threat modeling to be considered from the beginning in developing medical devices. And then, as Penny mentioned, they do see that there might be a need for additional regulation, and so they're also considering that. So our key takeaways from this talk are whole of community, which FDA has really been living, focusing on the whole life cycle, thinking about the impact on critical infrastructures. There's a lot of interdependence in healthcare on other sectors. I know Penny and I have participated in the sector meetings where they've done cross-sector exercises, and really healthcare is dependent on all the other sectors, is what we learned. There was an exercise to try to prioritize healthcare's dependence, and it was really quite interesting to think about. Shifting the mindset, they've really, as Penny talked about, they want to focus on, get away from this, go beyond, really, intended use. You know, they've focused on intended use and expected misuse, and adversaries are unexpected misuse, and so things need to be considered there. Threat modeling, as we talked about, and they really are looking at incentives, more and more incentives, as Penny described the one for the ISAOs. So applying what we learned today, this was a slide that we wanted to leave everyone with, thinking about medical device cybersecurity. First, I want to invite everybody up to the Medical Device Sandbox in the Innovation Sandbox area that's sponsored by the Biohacking Village. We have devices up there that people can look at and talk about. Our team that has been working in the lab with some of these devices is there to provide some instruction on that. And what we need for people to do, we have so many cyber experts here, to really start focusing on what could we be learning from other sectors that could be applied to healthcare. FDA is very interested in this, but it's important to really understand the differences in this sector too, because the impact to patient harm is really critical. So when you're thinking about applying traditional cybersecurity techniques, you really need to understand this patient safety aspect of it. And then we would encourage everybody, particularly the healthcare organizations who are not involved in the health sector, coordinating council. There's Greg Garcia leads the cybersecurity working group there. It's a very active group that have been producing guidance in different areas. They produced a joint security plan for medical devices this past year that was made up of a cross-stakeholder group that under the HICCP, the Healthcare Industry Cybersecurity Practices. That's another group that is producing best practices for hospitals. So at healthsectorcouncils.org is where the cybersecurity work is all being published. So it's really a great activity. And I think that wraps up our slides. So we have, our last slide is our FDA contacts who could not be here today, and our MITRE contacts. And we encourage everybody to visit the village, because we'll all be up there today and we can have more conversations. It's on the second floor of Moscone South. So do we have questions?
All really great stuff. So it's a two-part question. You're talking about the three requirements if there's a vulnerability found. And I didn't get all three, but I'll come back up. And then, so are there, is onerous reporting the only sanction? And combined with that, are financial penalties only available in the civil sector?
So, when safety issues are found in devices, essentially the reporting is kind of removals, kind of like a recall. And that's a difficult thing for manufacturers to do. And so FDA thought that providing that as an incentive would be sufficient to getting manufacturers to not just disclose the vulnerability, but be able to patch it and roll the patches out. So the three, so the three conditions to get the incentive are: there can't actually be any evidence of patient harm. So it's a vulnerability that's been discovered, but it hasn't actually affected anybody yet. If it has affected anybody, there would, FDA would probably go through a recall process with the manufacturer. The second condition is there's a 30 and 60 day time frame to try and control the vulnerability. So in the first 30 days, the manufacturer has to be able to communicate the vulnerability, develop some workarounds, get that communicated out. So within 30 days, some action has taken place. And then within 60 days, the vulnerability should actually be controlled. There should be a patch, and that patch should be, rolled out. They recognize that it might not happen in 60 days, and sometimes, they may be a little lenient and give a little extra time. In other cases, it just falls under the normal mechanisms, and the manufacturers don't get the incentive. I don't know that they, there are a whole range of actions that FDA can take, and, I think as one of the things that they're struggling with is this whole, legacy device issue. Yeah. Suzanne last year at HIM said, she'd like to see legacy devices out of hospitals in 5 years, and people were a little skeptical that that would ever happen in that time frame. But, one of the things that they're really trying to think about is how you deal with that and what other kinds of incentives you might need. Some of it might be punitive fines, some of it could be financial encouragement, some of it might involve rethinking models of how hospitals acquire devices. Maybe they lease devices and don't buy them, so they're no longer capital expenditures that have to be amortized over time.
The other thing I'm reminded of is the Healthcare Industry Cybersecurity Task Force report. So there was a year-long study with experts across the sector on all the topics of healthcare cybersecurity. And so that document was delivered to Congress in 2017, I believe. But it has a number of recommendations in there, and the healthcare, the sector is working on those recommendations, but that might be a good thing to read, and that's on that healthsectorcouncil.org page, that document.
So the onerous reporting is equivalent to recall?
It essentially is like a recall, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you.
This is a short one, guys. A really good talk. Thank you. There's this sort of perception that updating a medical device is really hard. That, there's all sorts of going back through the certification, and yet there's that tension of if you find a vulnerability, you want to update it quickly. Mm-hmm. Has the community thought much about that, and is there a consensus emerging about the tension between sort of recertification and the ability to patch?
So first of all, if the patch is solely for security, you do not have to go back to FDA to recertify the device. Manufacturers try to hide behind this all the time and say, oh, no, I can't do this. I have to go back to big, bad FDA. And, Suzanne, at every public opportunity and her team at every public opportunity say, no, if it's just for security, you don't have to come back to us. Yes, you have to determine that your patch is not going to affect the essential performance of the device. The onus is on you to do that, but you don't have to come back and do another pre-market approval or 510K clearance. And in fact, they have on their website, which the URL is there, they have a Mythbusters one-pager, and one of the top myths is you cannot patch. On the other hand, patching's difficult. We have heard from manufacturers that, it takes us like 6 months to run through our regression tests, and that suggests that maybe they're not doing things right, and they haven't really isolated the different components of the system. And so some manufacturers have been developing ways to speed up that regression testing process, that they've got a good notion of what the dependencies are, where the
what this patch is going to impact, the components the patch will impact, and they have an accelerated regression testing cycle so they can get the patches out faster. So I think there's a lot of work that needs to go there, but it is a myth that you have to go and recertify the device. You know, clearly if the patch is going to affect the essential performance, FDA will want them to come back and recertify. But if it's really just a security patch, they don't have to. And even if they have to go back to FDA, you know, I've been told that in some cases they can go and do the recertification in a couple of weeks. So, you know, they're just hiding. But one other thing I'd like to mention is, thanks to MedSec, we actually have a beta version of a calculator for the CVSS rubric. And so if anybody is interested in playing around with an Excel spreadsheet to use the rubric, you know, you can contact me. You know, we email me at pc@mitre.org, or we have an email alias securemed@mitre.org, and we can send you that draft calculator.
Peripheral question, but related to the topic. I do IT security at a hospital, and one of the things that I'm seeing emerging more and more often is requests for more complex medical devices to have egress to the internet for remote support functionality so that a technician can contact the vendor. As the security person, I'm really uncomfortable with a device that's directly connected to a patient talking out to the internet, but I can't cut off that access for support. Is this being discussed at the level of these conversations?
We know that it is a safety risk. There are some examples of incidents related to that. I think that it, you know, we do have a lot of challenges, and I think the really important thing is that the IT staff understands everything happening with the medical devices. Often in the hospitals, the medical device biomed team reports separately than IT. So we're encouraged that you have a good conversation going of knowing all the devices, but I think it's something that really has to be monitored.
Well, and I also think, you know, maybe in HCCP, you know, they can talk about some of the best practices for doing that.
Yeah.
I mean, for example, you know, you really don't want to have, you know, speaking as a patient who's had everything from multiple scans to radiation therapy, you know, you don't want somebody doing maintenance on the device while you're inside of it. And, you know, so, you know, there obviously are some, you know, simple, you know, best practices like that, but, you know, maybe it's something that HCCP should think about to provide some guidance in how you kind of handle that. I mean, we understand, I mean, there's some hospitals that refuse to have the technicians come in and put the devices online, and others, you know, don't, but you need to make sure, like, if it's put online, that it's taken off again when they're done. There's a famous case from Beth Israel Deaconess Medical Center, which John Halamka talks about, where a technician came in, put a device online, and while he went to lunch, didn't take it off, and 7,000 x-rays were exfiltrated to Shanghai. Why? Well, the FBI agent told Halamka that to get an exit visa to leave China, you have to demonstrate that you don't have TB. And so they're just scanning the networks, waiting for these devices to come online and do what they do.
Thank you very much.
Ladies, thank you to both of you for being here. I really learned a lot from this session. Many of us are from software vendors, and we're looking to, you know, address the space. Can you help us understand where we can learn more about the market size and market trends?
You know, I think that's really what we need here, is because so many great cyber solutions are out there, but I think tailoring them to the healthcare environment is really the critical piece. And where to learn from those is yeah.
Again, I think if you look at the industry task force report that Margie mentioned, there's a lot of information in there about the sector challenges and the size. And, in fact, the next question is by one of the task force members. Hi, Josh.
Thank you.
I'll follow up with you after, and I'll start with your point, which is, in broad brushstrokes, if you want to help serve this space, there are 10,000 medical device makers. The rough numbers I've heard is 10 are huge, 100 are large, and the rest have about 11 employees total. So,
or at least under 50.
One of the areas that is really challenging is we don't have 10,000 threat modelers to put around. Yeah. So one of the challenges that Matt Clapham and myself and Adam Shostak and Bo Woods have been trying to figure out is how do we scale threat modeling as a service to serve that need right away. Yep. Number two, real fast, is of all the health delivery organizations in the US, 85% of them are small, medium, and rural. And we found that if you're a large hospital, you have a pretty decent sized team. If you're small, medium, rural, you typically had zero security people on staff. So they tend to have flat, unsegmented networks. But I wanted to punctuate the prior IT guy's point. We encountered a Boston hospital who was sold a medical device, and the device vendor told them to open the firewall to those IPs. Yeah. And she said, which ports? And they said, all of them. And she had to go back and forth for weeks. She was the first hospital that actually pushed back on them, because it was much easier for them to say, just give us full access. And that tells me every single other customer of theirs just did what they were told for the convenience of remote telemetry. So we have to socialize some of these things, and the task force report might have other market requirements.
Right. Okay, I think we have a big stop sign. So we can take your question offline, but...
Come to the village.
Yeah, come to the village.